Well, Greene King describes itself as a proper pub, and its most recent trading update revealed that more of us spent Christmas Day at one of its public houses. Well, the group also runs the Lock Fine and Hungry Horse brands, plus the recently acquired Spirit Pub Company. Mark Blythman is the Director of Investor Relations. He joins us now. So Mark, now following the smoking ban way back in 2007, some said the pub industry was becoming as unpopular as nicotine. And even as recently as last year, some were saying, who's killing the British pub? But your trading figures are perhaps pointing to a resurgence in pub visitation.
Yeah, I think some of those, the death knells that were signed in 2007 and since then are premature. I think the British pub still has a very warm part in people's hearts in this country. It's still the most popular place to drink out and to eat out in the country. And if you do a good job at delivering great value for customers, providing a great service experience and continually trying to improve the quality of what you offer them, we think they'll keep coming back.
So in terms of the quality and the service, it's all part of the evolution, I suppose, because many pubs are redefining themselves as restaurants, cafes, music venues. Where I live, it's turned into sort of the local library as well since our mobile service has disappeared. So are you matching this evolution or are you at the forefront of it?
I think that where a pub needs to do something like that, then it's a great place to do it. So if you're in a small village community, as you said, where the mobile library stops to visit, it's a great place, a great space where people can add extra facilities like libraries, hairdressers, post offices, things like that. Most of our pubs are more in more urban areas where those facilities are still there. And I think we focus very much on being the best pub in each of the communities that we're in, as opposed to necessarily being a restaurant or a broader community facility. But it's about being the best at what you do, sticking to your knitting, but being the best at what you do.
Okay, so urban, that's where you're at. Who knows, you might end up going into some of the rural communities, but would you compare the pub part of the travel, leisure and hospitality sector to the oil and gas sector with so many distressed assets that there are opportunities out there for Greene King?
Definitely opportunities. I mean, what you've seen over the last 9 years since the financial crisis started to kick in with the queues outside Northern Rock in August 2007 is a complete shift in how our business is run. So we have got out of the pubs that we didn't think had a long-term future, and we've bought and we've built and we've developed pubs where we think there is a long-term future. So we've made lots of changes, we've taken advantage of the opportunities, and you know, that's helped us to get to a position today where we are you know, hopefully one of the biggest and the best in the sector.
In terms of building and becoming the biggest, what was the rationale behind the Spirit Pub Company acquisition, and was it immediately earnings accretive?
First of all, clarify, our aim is not to be the biggest. We just happen to be up there with one or two of our peers, but our aim is to try and be the best. Spirit allowed us to bring a load of brands that we didn't have. A good example would be Chef and Brewer, which is a brand that lots of people know. We didn't really have a brand in that part of the market. So we'll buy some nice brands to join our stable of brands. They had some great assets. If you walk around the streets of London, you'll see some pretty famous pubs like the Albert in Victoria and the Salisbury, and pubs that are icons, if you like. So some great brands, some great assets, and also there were a few things they did in terms of how they operated that were a bit better than us, so we could get some learnings. Areas around digital marketing, particularly, they're very good at, and we can learn from them. So there's lots of benefits that they brought to the business. That's all strategic. Clearly the city likes to know, well, what are the numbers? And obviously by putting two big businesses together, there are quite a few synergies that we can generate through better purchasing power and improved distribution and reducing some of the central costs. So yeah, hopefully it's a deal that the city likes.
So we talked earlier about consolidation. Would you say that the industry is highly fragmented? Are you going to be part of that consolidation story? You know, you've made one acquisition, the Spirit one, which you say is good, and you hope the city likes it.
Well, it depends how you look at the industry. The pub industry has just under 50,000 pubs. We have 3,000. So that's a small market share in terms of the number of pubs. But if you look at the wider industry of sort of eating and drinking out, you have restaurants and cafes and coffee shops and things like that, we're even smaller. So yes, the pub industry is still fragmented, but the wider industry that we compete in is massively fragmented, and there's huge opportunities for the long term for a business like ours.
There's one thing that is going to affect your entire industry, and it's about the planned increase in the UK national minimum wage. You employ over 42,000 people, half of them under the age of 25. How will that affect the bottom line? How are you gearing yourself up to that event?
Yeah, it's going to be a direct impact on the P&L, but we've spent some time trying to work out ways in which we can mitigate some of that cost increase. And one of the key things is around better utilisation of those 42,000 people. So making sure through a more systemic approach to it that they are in the pubs working at the right times. It's about training and developing people so that they stay with us longer and are more effective and are more productive. And, you know, there are some indirect benefits. I mean, you know, if everybody moves on to the national minimum or national living wage, you know, there's going to be more money in some of our customers' pockets, and we hope to see some of that coming back into the pubs as well. So it's certainly not all doom and gloom. We're talking about a maximum of £6 million impact in 3 years' time. And, with a business that sort of makes between 300 and 400 million, you know, it's not a huge impact in the end, but we'll be working very hard to make sure that that impact is kept to a minimum.
Let's have a look at another number. You know, with businesses such as yours, the benchmark figure is the operating margin. And for us who don't know what the operating margin is, it's the proportion of revenue left over after paying variables, you know, wages, raw materials. And your figures from December reveal a marginal drop in the margin. So what steps are you taking to lift it above the 20% threshold?
Well, I'm not here today to give a target on our margins. I think there was a specific factor in the first half of our financial year which impacted on the margins, which is the acquired Spirit business. So with an extra rental line, a cost line in their P&L, that naturally just brought the margin down slightly. And then we worked very hard to try and bring it back up to where it was at the same time last year. Look, we're constantly trying to, the strength of our margin is one of the key parts of why people invest in our business. And we're constantly trying to, keep it up around that 20% mark. Input cost inflation at the moment, energy, other raw materials is not high. The biggest factor, which you've just mentioned, is the cost of labour. That's probably the biggest pressure on our business at the moment.
How crafty is Greene King becoming? You've got your flagship, you know, IPA and Old Speckled Hen, but they've been around quite a long time. I'm wondering if you've got a master brewer and there's more of your own signature craft ales coming into the pubs.
The cask ale industry has had a rough time in the sort of 60s and 70s as everybody started to drink lager. With the help of Camra and brewers like us who have persisted in producing cask ale all through the 70s and the 80s and the 90s, the revival in cask ale, and you could call it, you know, craft ale as well, which includes some of the keg beers and lager beers as well, has been great for the business. And there's a really important place on the bar for brands that people know. So like Greene King IPA, like Old Speckled Hen. But at the same time, people want to experiment and investigate. And we couldn't ignore that. So after the Chancellor first froze, got rid of the beer duty escalator and then started cutting beer duty, we used some of that money to reinvest in something called the St. Edmunds Brewhouse, which is, if you like, a craft brewery within the bigger Greene King brewery. It allows us to do smaller runs and experiment more and try different things. And out of that process, a couple of beers that are doing really, really well at the moment would be London Glory, which is aimed particularly at the London market. And with all the London pubs we've acquired with Spirit, I think you'll see more growth in that brand. And something called East Coast IPA, which is a sort of zesty, light ale, looks a bit like a lager but tastes like an IPA, which is also doing very well. So they're a couple to watch out for.
Talk to me about the Chinese interest in IPA. There was a, you know, I thought it was a nation of whiskey drinkers, and yet you had an unexpected endorsement from the Chinese President Xi Jinping.
Well, they definitely weren't a nation of ale drinkers until that point in time. There have been a couple of interesting benefits to us from that. Obviously, the key one being that the president is revered in China, so everybody wanted to know what it was he had drunk and wanted to drink it. So we had, I think it was a 16-fold increase in our exports to China before Christmas. So we shipped a lot of Greene King IPA out on a big boat in a big container in time for the Chinese New Year. And the orders are still coming through, which is great. And then there's a lovely side issue, which is the tourist centre, the visitor centre that we have at the brewery has become very popular with Chinese tourists. So they found their way to Bury St Edmunds, and we see groups of Chinese tourists taking photos of anything Greene King and then going on the tour. So a couple of nice benefits for us.
That's magical. I'm wondering about the magic, the revenues from Loch Fyne and Hungry Horse. What do the revenues from those two brands reveal about consumer confidence?
Consumer confidence is still, I think 2015, it was the first year since records began that every single month of the year was positive on the consumer confidence metric. So from that point of view, you've got to say consumers are reasonably confident. I think that having had so many years of a financial crisis and the recession and low interest rates and trying to prepare the personal balance sheets and so on and so forth, a lack of wage growth, I think people are in a mindset which is caution. You know, they don't spend with the same sort of level of abandon that they might have done pre-2007. And I think it'll take a while for that to rinse through. People also spent years not buying the new car or not going on the expensive holiday or not buying the sofa. And I think we've seen a bit of pent-up demand there. When you look at those two brands specifically, Hungry Horse, obviously at the lower end of the price spectrum, and it did incredibly well during the recession. People traded down from restaurants, people looked for more value, and we invested in the brand and we redesigned the brand and it really went very, very well. And I think, you know, it's a brand that we're going to keep as we put the two businesses together and we're going to expand it. We've talked about, at the moment we're at sort of 250. We've told the city that we'll be between sort of 275 and 325 just from our existing estate. Plus, we're adding new sites every year. So it's still a brand we're going to invest in. It's still a brand doing really well. Loch Fyne, it's been an interesting journey for us with Loch Fyne because obviously we bought it just before the financial crisis, which in hindsight wasn't the greatest timing, but you know, we can plan as much for the future, but we can't predict everything. And so we've worked really, really hard for people when they go to Loch Fyne. You know, they go in there and they say, oh, this, you know, this is great, this is a great fish restaurant. They still buy a lot of their produce from the loch itself. And you know, we have a deal with Loch Fyne Oysters. We get all the mussels and all the oysters and things like that from the loch still. And that they still have a premium fish eating out experience. It's not everybody's cup of tea, but those that like it love it. And it still ticks along very nicely.
So finally, you can't predict the future because you've just told me so, but how confident or cautious is Greene King about 2016?
We are quietly confident. I think our big challenge is, with a big acquisition like Spirit, our big challenge is to make sure that we not only integrate Spirit successfully, but we keep the core business running to a level that is expected by our key stakeholders. And that's a real, you know, that's what we're really, really focusing on. The external research tells us that the consumer should continue to spend this year, that real income growth should continue. So as long as we keep doing our job, we keep doing a good job, we keep giving them, as I said at the beginnings, you know, great value, great service, great quality, then I think we can continue to meet internal and external expectations.
Thank you very much. Mark Blythman, Investor Relations Director at Greene King. Thank you very much indeed for joining me.